Hi everyone, it's George here. There are still a few people creeping in at the back, but I think I'll crack on anyway. I think I'll just start with a little bit of an introduction about myself. I'll try to keep it brief for your sanity. I can see quite a few of my clients are in here already, but for those of you who don't know me, my name's George Brown. I'm Key Account Manager at Virtual Cabinets. I look after most of our clients who are around the 150 to 1,000 user mark. But my background, for my sins, I was an accountant for just about a decade. And then for reasons I'm sure you can't imagine, I fell out of love with it and decided to do something else. So I got a job on the technical support help desk at what was then Linden House. Did that for a couple of years and then moved into installations and training, consultancy, project management. And then about 3 years ago, I started doing the job I'm doing now. So the point to all of that really is to say that I've been around a while and I've seen most things. So really, irrespective of the size of your firm or the industry that you work in, either from a technical or a processed related matter, I probably can help you out in any problems that you're having. So if you have a question, please, please feel free to write it down in the question box at the bottom. If it's a quick and easy one, I'll answer it there and then. If it's a bit more lengthy, I'll answer it in the proper Q&A session at the very end of the presentation. And if it's horrendous and convoluted, then I think we'll probably have a conversation about it another time. I'll give you my contact details at the end, and obviously I or your account manager will be more than happy to discuss anything you want, really. So crack on with the presentation now. As you're aware, it's about different things that we have created within Virtual Cabinet or using some bouncing off some other third party bits of software to try to make your lives easier if possible. I think generally we can agree, other than life happiness, the main objective from being at work is to have a conversation with a client, scope out the work that you want to do, raise a quote, get it signed and agreed, do the work, and then get paid for it. I mean, that's the process that pretty much everyone goes through, whether you work in manufacturing or banking. It doesn't really matter. So there are certain bits in that process that you can't really speed up too much. The relationship building with the client, the scope of the work, the physical work itself, it takes as long as it takes. But it's those little bits of admin-y stuff that goes in the middle, the raising of the quotes, the chasing them for signature, all of that stuff. And then if you work in, I don't know, accountancy, legal, I mean, really any industry, the regulatory compliance stuff that you have to adhere to, the external auditors, all the compliancy bits that, you know, we all despise, apart from compliance officers who love it, of course, those little bits that we view as a hardship, those are the bits that we try to take away and automate so that you guys don't have to worry about them anymore. So, as per the title and as per this slide, I won't insult your intelligence by reading them all out individually. I'm sure you can all read perfectly well. Those are the five things that I'm going to be concentrating on today, working from left to right. And the first of those things is email. Just very quickly before I get into that, I suspect that there are elements of all of these things that most of you hopefully are using already. If you're not, great. If you are, hopefully you'll find something that is better than what you are currently doing. But yes, feel free to discuss it with us afterwards if you wish. So email, loads of us receive loads of it. I dread to think how many I get in a day. My boss is probably worse. And getting rid of it or dealing with it and certainly filing it is both important and time consuming. So the other thing that's necessary is if you're a firm, it doesn't actually matter how big a firm you are, if you're a 12 person team in a big firm or a 12 person company, if I am conversing with a client and I go away on holiday or I get sick and nobody can get into my inbox for, I don't know, 4 hours until IT get around to sorting it out, that's lost time, it's wasted time. No one knows what I've said to the client. So we try to always work from this position of universal accessibility for all communication with clients. So basically, as soon as an email is written and sent or received, we like to get it into Virtual Cabinet as fast as possible so that everyone be able to find out very, very quickly what's being discussed and agreed with the client. So we have three main ways of dealing with this. The first is by email address. So as you are hopefully all aware, VC has the ability to integrate with most third-party software solutions. And there are some caveats to that, but particularly the database related ones, a lot of the CRMs, a lot of the big practice management softwares, we can just go straight into them and we can see that for client code X, email address is this. So as soon as an email is sent to or received from that email address, we will automatically file that email against that client code under correspondence with the description as the subject line, fire and forget, job done. So that works particularly well for like a one-to-one relationship. So one of my clients deals almost exclusively with contractors, one-man bands, sole traders, single employee limited companies. So when they are having an email conversation with an email address, it is usually only relevant to one company. So this is a perfect solution for them. Just fire and forget, job done. The next one is subject line. So again, we are referring back to your third party database, the CRM, and we are looking for a client code or a piece of filing information that you choose. So normally this would be client code. So you put the client code in the subject line, you send the email, VC reads the subject line, and if there's a client code in there, we file it, easy. Now, if you work in a different industry, so let's say insurance, wealth management, that sort of thing, if you've got a client who has one email address, but they've got 30 policies out with you, you don't want it filing by email address because you don't know which policy they're talking about. So what we do for them instead is we say, well, if you put your policy number into the subject line, we can then refer back to that. We'll file it against the right client because we know that client has that policy number, but you will be able to search on the policy. So it's a much more refined search. So people will be able to find what they need as fast as possible. And really, that's the core point of VC, is so that people can find everything rapidly. So that's what we use the subject line for. The final one, which is newer and requires a very, very small amount of human interaction at the beginning of the process, but is much more tailored a fit, is conversations and suggestions. Now, I will just quickly flick over to my other screen so that I can show you what these look like. It'll make much more sense when you can see what I'm doing. Just bear with me. Okay, so this is what the suggestions look like. So on the left-hand side, as per normal, you've got an email address you're writing to, you have a subject line that you've written in, and then the body of the email, whatever, doesn't really matter. What conversations and suggestions do is it learns over time what you are doing with particular emails. So if you have a client who you work for who may have 15 limited companies, you don't want to file every email against all of those companies. You need to be able to specify which of the companies you're actually talking about. So if I send one email and I file it against one company, the next time I go to write this person an email, over here on the right hand side where the suggestion bar is, it says, last time you wrote to this guy, this is where you filed this email. Do you want to file it there again? And in this case, the answer is no, I want to file it under a different one. If it was yes, obviously I'd just click that. But in this case, I'm going to skip it. That then takes me through to the filing area. So most of this is defaulted in because when I'm sending my correspondence, I know that I'm going to file it in the client's cabinet. I'm going to file it under correspondence. I want the subject line to be the description and I want today's date to be the document date. So all of that is already done. I don't have to worry about that. The only thing I need to worry about is who the client is. So I pick that. It's perfectly possible yours are linked between client code and client name. Mine isn't. Pick those, click file, job done. As soon as I send the email, that document will then go into Virtual Cabinet in that area. Just as a little added Brucey bonus on the indexing pane, you can see there now where that document has been filed. If that person then responds, the point of the conversations part of this is that as I file that initial email, I send my email, they receive it, they respond back to me, and then Virtual Cabinet recognizes that these two emails are part of the same conversation, and it automatically files their response in exactly the same place as I filed my initiating email, and forwards and backwards, And then if it turns out that this is a client that I've got a personal relationship with and we start talking about the cricket or the football or whatever, I can just kill that conversation at that point, end it, and then carry on talking about whatever. And then if at some point we come back to being professional again, we can then reinstate the conversation and just carry on as we were previously. When this person responds to me, their email will be filed and it will say on the right-hand side where that email is filed. So if I get a response from them that says, oh, can you just sort me out with a copy of my tax return from last year or something like that, rather than having to go into VC, do a manual search on the client code and on the document type and so on, I can just click on their client code here, and that will then go off and do an automated search in VC and pull back the whole client file for me, from which I can then pull the tax return and just stick it straight into the email for them. Like so, and if, you know, stick filters in there and all the groupings and all the usual stuff, get what I need, send it to them, and off it goes. So again, it's just about taking those little mouse clicks out here and there. If you're doing 50 a day that we can take away over the course of a year and 20 staff, you're talking about a lot of time and a lot of effort that has just been disbanded, and you've not lost any of the quality of service you're providing to your clients. That's really all this is about. So that is all I have to say about emails at present. The next bit, automated document filing. My suspicion is, as I said, most of you have got some form of email capture in place at the moment. My equal suspicion is that you probably don't have anything that's a fully automated piece of document capture. So again, we've got a couple of different ways of doing this, both equally valid in different scenarios. It depends on what your use case is. And again, if you come to us with a problem, we will sit down in a room and figure out a solution to it. So the first two of these that I'm going to go into are pure automated filing of documents, usually en masse, but they can be done singly as well. The first is using virtual printers. So if you are doing something like a mail merge in Word, or if you are an Iris user and you use auto mail or something like that, and you're producing reasonably large volumes of near identical letters. So let's say you're sending out tax reminders to 1,000 clients on a particular day of the year. Up until very recently, my suspicion again is that you printed them all out manually, and then some poor soul had to sit there, stuff them all into envelopes. Someone probably had to sign them or PP sign them, because partners aren't going to be doing that. Envelope them, stamp them, send them, and then hope that they arrive at some point. So what we've done is we've slightly amended that process so that at the very, very least, you can get all of these documents into VC without having to do any work yourself. And then at least you've got a record of the fact that the letter was created and sent and so on and so forth. So I'll show you how these look. So I've got a letter here, standard tax request letter, we need to have a chat at some point. And then on the next one, I've got another one, which is pretty much identical. The only difference is the client name. Sorry, let me just switch my screen. Probably be helpful. Sorry, try that again. Yes, so now you can see a letter on the left-hand side, which is a standard tax request letter. And then underneath, I've got another one. Only difference is the client and the address. What is different to a standard mail merge or an auto mail output is this stuff here on the right hand side. So this would be automatically created as part of the mail merge that you were doing. And it includes all of the information that you want VC to use when it files this document. So you take these, I've only got two here, I don't need 400 of them just to prove a point, the theory is the same. You take these 400 letters that you've written, the trailer pages, bring in this merge information of who the client code is, who the client name is, as part of the mail merge. You then print them to a virtual printer, which is just looks the same as a normal printer, except it doesn't exist. VC will then take the first page, put it into virtual cabinet with the filing information from the second page, strip out the second page, move on to the next letter, take that, file it with the second page, strip out the second page. And it just does that as many times as you need it to, whether that's once or 10,000. Some of my insurance clients are going through 100,000 of these a month, and it just blitzes them and they just don't have to worry about it. So they then end up in VC. What happens with the setup of these is, because once you understand basically the concept of what indexes are and what the labels are and how the mail merge fits together, we teach you all of that, obviously, And then we generally leave you to your own devices. I mean, if it breaks, obviously we'll fix it, but it's quite a simple process. So when we've showed people how to put a couple of these together, we just walk away and maybe we'll come back in 6 months and they've got 50 of these that they're using for very, very common documents. So that's virtual printers. Hopefully that made some sort of sense. The next thing we're going to talk about is watch folders. I will just show you a little example of one of these. So what a watch folder is it's just a network share, like a Windows folder, but it's one that Virtual Cabinet is permanently watching to see if something pops up into it. And what we did some years ago is, as you hopefully know, as soon as a document goes into Virtual Cabinet, we OCR it, we extract the text from it, and then we make that text content searchable, so you can look for the contents of a document. So we thought to ourselves, well, if we already have the information that's within the document, why can't we use that as a basis for filing information? And of course, there is no reason, so we built it. So this is an example, a perfect example of how watch folders can be useful. So one of my clients, who shall forever remain nameless, was one day asked to provide some anti-money laundering proof for one or two of their clients. And they discovered, after not having those two, that they didn't actually have any for any of their clients. So panic ensued, but fair play to them. What they did, they realized they had a problem, so they went away and fixed it. So they sent Dun & Bradstreet a list of all of their clients, individuals, companies, everything, and said, we need authentication that all of these people are effectively kosher. So they knew they were, they knew they'd done the checks, they just couldn't prove it. So they went to Dun & Bradstreet, paid them an obscene amount of money, I expect, to do all of this. But they said to Dun & Bradstreet, when you have done this for each of these clients, we want a PDF back from you that contains our client code, our client name, the date it was done, and your authentication code to prove that we can, you know, if we need to prove it at a later date, that code will be valid. So what these guys were then left with at the end of that process was about 12,000 PDFs of confirmations of AML proofs. Someone was going to have to sit there and individually file those manually. Thankfully, they came to me beforehand and said, look, we've got this situation. Is there anything you can do for us? And we said, yeah, actually, as it happens, there is. So what we do with the OCRing is we create a template and we tell VC to look out for certain bits of information within a document. So in this case, we told it to look for anti-money laundering confirmation. We said, wherever you see the words client code, what comes after is the client code. See the name, what comes after is the name, and then there's your date. So we set this all up for them, and then they took these 12,000 PDFs, dropped them into a watch folder, and about 24 minutes later, all 12,000 of them were filed against every single client, and nobody had to do anything. So absolutely perfect solution for them, and that's what it can be used for. It doesn't necessarily have to be for stuff that's in that kind of volume. You could, in theory, create a tax return in wherever you like and just drop it into a watch folder and it'll just file to a client. You could create a set of accounts, you could create a cover letter, basically anything that looks the same every single time apart from small deviations in details, you can drop into a watch folder and VC will file it. Fine. So the last bit, I've sort of got one and a half automations to talk about here. The last bit I'm going to talk about as a full point is integrations with third-party bits of software. So as I've alluded to already, we can see databases and we can pull information and so on and so forth, but there are certain bits of software that we have much deeper integrations with. And we, as a software provider, have always been very, very happy to speak to any third-party software company and their developers to say, look, one of our clients has come to us with this situation. They would like a button here that does this. We will handle what happens after the button is pushed, but can you put that button in for us? And quite often they say yes. So if you don't ask, you don't get, right? So people like Sage, Digita, IPS, Iris, IntelliFlow, all of those ones there, we've got really, really deep integrations with. If you have a third-party piece of software that we don't currently integrate with in any way, and I'm talking client lists, ex-clients, name change re-indexes, all of that stuff, please do get in touch with us because that is bread and butter stuff for us and it will make your life easier. Like if a client changes their name or gets married or divorced or whatever, if someone is having to go in and manually re-index 1,000 documents, to change that name. I mean, that's lunacy. We can get the databases to talk to each other. And as soon as you change it in your CRM, VC will update automatically. I mean, stuff like that, just ask us. If you don't know it exists, obviously I don't blame you, but just ask us. If you've got something that's irritating you, we can't fix it if we don't know. So what I would like to do just very quickly on this integration business is show you an integration between ourselves and a company called IPS, or Turnkey is the company. IPS is the software. If you work in insolvency or you have an insolvency arm, you will know these guys. They've got 90-odd% of the market, massive market leader. But they're a nice company. We got on very well with them. And some of our clients came to us and said, look, we need an integration here. So we got some of our clients, some of our developers, and some of their developers, got them all into a room, asked our clients, what do you want this integration to do? They told us, and then all the different developers went and scurried into a corner somewhere and did their thing. And then they created this integration. It's only a minute long, but you'll get the gist of the sort of thing that we're looking to be able to do. So this actually looks a lot like Digita if you use Digita, and the integration with Digita is very similar. So this person's creating a report, income and expenditure of this particular case, insolvency case. That will appear very shortly as so. And then to get it into VC against the right client, against the case number with the correct date, the correct document, just click that button, click yes, done. That document is now in VC. So you haven't had to do any manual filing. If you don't want it in VC, you want to stick it on a memory stick or something similar, just click no, put it on the desktop, put it on a memory stick, click save, job done. I mean, that is how an integration should work. It should just be, I need to do this, click a button, it's done. Equally, so that was filing. Here we want to do searching. So when you've created a bunch of documents and or someone phones in and makes a request, you want to review the case, click on that button, it goes off, makes a call to Virtual Cabinet and brings up every document related to that case. In this case, it's just the one that we created just now. But again, you shouldn't have to keep dipping in and out of different bits of software. They should all just talk to each other properly. So that's where we try to get to. So if you've got something you'd like us to look at in that respect, just please do ask. The half sort of integration that I was talking about, or automation that I was talking about, is document creation. Now, this has been pretty popular, so it's perfectly possible a lot of you are using it already. But as a little bit of background, what we found came up quite regularly with our clients was template management. So the probability is, if you're not using document creation, that you have a network share somewhere with a whole load of Word templates in it. Over time, people edit them, change them, copy them, delete them, you know, all the usual horrendous things that people do with documents. And then people take their own copies and keep them on their desktops because they don't trust someone else to mess with them. And then someone gets tasked with tidying them up and they do half a job and it ends up messier than it was. And, you know, I'm pretty certain everyone will have been there. So what we did in VC was created a template library area, which certain people can edit, not many, and as many people as you wish can access and create documents from. So firstly, that gets rid of your issue with people mucking about with stuff. But the clever part of it all is that when we have these templates in here, we also talk to your CRM or your practice management software to pull in the client data for the letter that we are creating. So here, for example, I have an aid memoir. I double click on it. I pick my client. That then goes off to the CRM, pulls in all of this stuff, address details, partner details, etc. I click on create document. That then goes off and looks at the template, grabs this info that I've just got from the CRM, pushes the two together, and then pre-fills that letter with all of that client information. It's just a Word document, so I can free type in here if I want to. But the other bit that it does is, because it knows which client that I'm talking about when I created this letter, when I close this down, it says, do you want to save this as a copy in Virtual Cabinet? I say yes. And then not only have I not had to check all the details in my CRM because it pulled it through, I also haven't had to file it because VC has filed it against that client for me. Right, so that is document creation. I think for those of you that do use the portal, hopefully most of you, as opposed to email for sending, you know, stuff for signature. I think when we created the portal and we started looking at our OCRing and the watch folder stuff that I was talking about just a minute ago, I think a very natural progression for us mentally in terms of what we wanted the software to do was that if you create a document and put it into a watch folder and it automatically files, that's great. But then someone has to go and find it and send it or print it or email it or whatever it is that they're going to do. So why not use the information that we already have? And at the point of filing, also use that information to publish it out for signature. So if I create a tax return and there's a VAT number, not a VAT number, like a UTR number or something along those lines, I can take that UTR out of the VAT number, out of the tax return, sorry, and then go off to the CRM and go, right, well, I know that for this UTR, this is that person's email address, file it against that client as a tax return and also publish it to them for signature without me having to do anything. And in terms of the technical side of things, from your perspective, it's no different. We will help you set these templates up. We will show you how they fit together and we will show you how to put those little bits of, do you want to publish it? Yes. Does it need a signature? Yes. Does it need auto retract? Yes, etc. We'll help you do all of that. But the process itself, once it's all set up, is extremely simple. I will show you now. So here, this one, I just have a document that was created, just a request for a conversation, really. All I have to do is drop that into my watch folder, like so. It sits there for probably 3 or 4 seconds, they're gone. And then pretty well instantaneously, if I go back into my VC, you can see here now, and those of you who do use the portal will probably have noticed this little cloud at the end there. So that document has now been filed under the correct client, correct date, correct everything, and then has also been published out to that client. And then I can come in here and see when it was published, have they read it, have they signed it, do I need to send a reminder, et cetera, et cetera. Very, very simple, really. So back to here. There are a few other little bits around automated publishing that I think it would probably be worth just touching on, I think. Probably the most important is, just from an anecdotal perspective, is the automated retraction of documents in the portal. In the admin tab of VC, which hopefully you'll be familiar with, if not, try to be, there's a button called Configure portal settings there, and then within there is the option to be able to auto retract. Now, the reason I have this is a cautionary tale from one of my clients who very heavy users of automated publishing, very heavy users of the portal in general, actually, and a big firm. They never set an auto retract on their portal, and they called me up after about 9 months and said, we're running out of portal space basically every 4 days. What's going on? We found out they didn't have an auto retract, but that they also had about 250,000 documents up in the portal, which were going to sit there permanently had they never asked us to sort it out for them, which obviously we duly did. But here is where you set that. I would set it to optional. There is a yes and a no option, but optional means that there will be a default, and then if the user wishes to, they can override it. So if you're sending, I don't know, a pension statement or an insurance policy or something like that, which has a finite period for which it exists, which might be a year, you can change it to a year. Generally speaking, I leave it to a month. If I'm sending someone a quote, it's only valid for 30 days. So if they haven't signed it after a month, then it's no longer valid anyway. So it just keeps things nice and tidy. And from your client's perspective, when they log into the portal, they like to see relevant, concise, useful information. They don't want pages and pages of rubbish that just isn't tidy because you haven't set this one tick box up. So yeah, highly recommended that one. The other thing that I would mention about automated publishing and actually publishing in general as well is the concept of delegated publishing. So if I sending out lots and lots of quotes to my clients, hopefully, my team, if I'm away, can find out what I've been up to, but not that easily. particularly useful for tax teams, accounts teams, you know, people who are doing reasonably high throughput stuff and their work is fairly sort of cross-positional. Everyone can do everyone's jobs. And if someone's off, someone jumps into their seat and they pick it up really, really quickly. Payroll teams, really good example. Finance teams, invoicing, purchase orders, another really good example. If I send this stuff out and it comes back signed, people need to be able to get into my intro. So what we've done is we've created this concept of delegated publishing, where I create a pseudo user in Virtual Cabinet called the finance team or the payroll team. And then as I publish, VC doesn't publish it from me, it publishes it as from the payroll team. So when the recipient gets it, they log in, they look at the document, they click the sign button. And then when the signed document comes back into a VC intray, it doesn't come to my intray or my colleague's intray. Everybody's signed documents go into a single central intray so that everybody can just go in there, look at it. And as you know, if you're a portal user, when a signed document comes in, all of the filing information is pre-filled. But it does mean when you know it's come back in and the whole team knows it's come back in, you can then move on to the next stage of that process, whatever that document may be. Right, so that's published delegation. The next thing I'm going to speak about is automated security. Now, this has become much, much more prevalent in the last couple of years than it was previously, I would say, and not just because of a GDPR perspective, but from a general compliance perspective and so on. I think, you know, people in the news and the media and general business practices are now much safer than they used to be. And people know this stuff has to happen, but organizing it and maintaining it can be something of a pain. So again, what we've done is try to automate as much of it as possible so you don't have to worry about it. Now, some of this is really very obvious. You know, no one should be seeing other people's payroll information in VC. Partners are all squirreling away in corners doing deals and things. Nobody needs to know about what they're up to. The owner's exactly the same. Those we can handle very easily. So in VC, as you're hopefully aware, you can set security from a filing cabinet level, section level, document type, all the way down to individual document level. Those are quite easy. So payroll filing cabinet, you just add a group called payroll and only give that group access to that filing cabinet. Very easy. The more interesting, in inverted commas, side of things is where you have individual clients who you may not want everybody to be able to see. So if you've got someone who's in the media or a local MP or a big landowner or something that people would like to be nosy to find out about, whether for good reasons or bad, if they're just being nosy or if they want to sell it, you as a business have an obligation to that client of yours to make sure that the risk is as minimal as possible for those bits of information to get out into the public domain. So we have a method in Virtual Cabinet whereby you can make certain clients totally invisible to almost everybody, should you so desire. They will still be within that client's cabinet. So if I've got the access rights to see 80% of the clients and I do a full search on that cabinet, I just get those 80%. And it might be that one of my colleagues only has access to 40%, but it's a different 40%. Whatever they search on, they only get to see what they see. And all of that is set within the security area of Virtual Cabinet, which I'll show you in just a second. The second kind of following on point to that is where you may have, you know, if you're a local firm and you generally employ local people and most of your clients are reasonably local, a lot of my accountancy clients are like that. It's perfectly possible that you will have a husband and wife who are local business owners. You know, you do their taxes, you do their pensions, you do their payroll, and one of their children or one of their nephews or nieces or friend of a friend ends up working for you in the firm. You again have an obligation to make sure that that person doesn't have access to those documents because that client probably doesn't want their niece knowing how much they earn, obviously. So again, that is set within VC itself. I'll show you how that works. It's really very simple. So in here, we have a bit called, I'll do groups first. So hopefully some of you use groups already, depending on what you use them for access, for intrays, that sort of thing. But there is a concept of a group here called Everybody But Me. So what this is you add every member in the company, one click, and then you just remove one user. And then that becomes the Everybody But George group. It's where all the cool kids hang out. And then in security profiles, what you have is a list of client codes. So here I've just got three. So this top one, for example, very high profile client. The only people who are allowed to see any of this are top level admin users, and they can see everything anyway. Managers can view the documents, partners can view and edit the documents, and then a few very select individuals underneath who aren't part of those groups do have access to the documents just to carry out their working duties, presumably. The other bit is the anyone but George B group. So here you would go, everyone but George can view, edit and re-index, click save and close. And then as soon as you close that, what VC does is it goes over all the existing documents for that client code and re-indexes them to the new security profile. And any document that goes in against those client codes in future will automatically be re-indexed to that security profile. So once this is done, you never have to worry about the wrong people seeing these documents ever again. And that actually is that we have to do a bit of jiggery pokery in the background. But as far as you as a user and administrator of Virtual Cabinet is concerned, that's about as complicated as it gets. Yeah, one final point on that is mobile app. If you are one of our clients who started using the mobile app or is looking at using it, the security profiling is mapped identically from the desktop version to the mobile version. It's done on a user by user basis. So you don't need to worry that if one of your juniors starts using the app, you know, to do tasks on holiday or whatever, they will not be able to suddenly see everyone's payroll information. It just carries across from one to the other. Right, the last thing I'm going to speak about is archiving, retention, and destruction of documents. Now, this again has become much, much more prevalent recently than before. There was a big hoo-ha about it when GDPR came out. I don't think the scaremongering that some people may be blamed for was entirely justified, but equally, it is still a legal requirement, and if you can tick the box without having to put yourself out too much, why wouldn't you, I think is the question. So this is where we would be talking not necessarily about things like subject access requests. I mean, really, if stuff's being filed properly in VC in the first place, the subject access request should take you no more than about 10 minutes. It's things like the right to be forgotten. It's things like, you know, stuff you might not even think of. If you have an employee who leaves, what happens to all of their documents in VC? Is someone actually physically going in and manually destroying those documents a year after they left? Do you have to keep certain contracts for 6 years? That sort of thing. If you're prospecting someone and they, God forbid, end up going with one of your competitors, at that point, you should probably really be destroying all of those pieces of documentation. I mean, from a legal perspective, the probability is you're never going to get strung out for it. But from a legal perspective, you should not be holding that prospecting information for any longer than you need it. So that's just the sort of peripheral stuff. The main bits, obviously, are around client information and ex-clients as well. So again, we can create an ex-client, and as soon as an ex-client's cabinet, and as soon as a client is marked as no longer acting in your practice management software, we can then immediately move all of these documents out of your current client's cabinet and into your ex-client's cabinet. So it's just about tidiness, really. I'm always willing to bang the drum for the legal side of things, but ultimately it's about how pleasant we can make the experience of using VC for your users, but making you as a business compliant at the same time. So what we tend to do, and I'll show you this in my VC now. So what we tend to do is we will create, or there will already be, a client's filing cabinet, and then we create another one, which from a regulatory perspective is totally unnecessary, but from an ease of use perspective is very helpful. Another one, which will be all documents for clients that are between 3 and 7 years old. And as soon as a document date hits a particular age, whether that's 2 years or 4 years or, you know, whatever you choose really, we will start moving them into that other cabinet. So the upshot of that for your users is when they go in, we found when speaking to our clients that they tend, or their users particularly tend, 95% of their searches will be for documents in the last 2 years. You're looking at this year's stuff or last year's stuff. Obviously, you can't just start ditching stuff when it's 2 years old, but it means that when they do a search on a client code, if they are not brilliant at using VC in terms of searching, or they're lazy, or they just don't know, they'll probably just come in and do a client code search, and then they'll moan at you that they're getting too many search results back. So you up your maximum limit to 5,000, and then for no logical reason whatsoever, they will then happily sit there and trawl through 5,000 documents trying to find a single email, because that's the most sensible way they can think of for doing it. Now, training issues aside, if we removed all documents older than 2 years from that list, they're probably only going to be looking through 100. So you've already saved them thousands and thousands of seconds of effort just by taking the ability to look at rubbish away from them. So that's why we put that one in. And then the final one, the 7 years plus, these are just arbitrary numbers that we've picked purely from an accountancy perspective. If you work in pensions and you need to keep stuff for 30 years, or life insurance and you need to keep stuff for 60 years, or mortgages and it's 40 years, it doesn't matter. If you've got a documented retention policy, we can replicate that digitally and put it into VC. So we can exclude stuff as well. So if you've got a permanent file where you keep letters of engagement, contracts, anti-money laundering stuff, that sort of thing that's referred back to all the time and is never going to be destroyed for any reason, we'll just never move it. You just tell us what you want, where you want it, and how you want it dealt with, and we will just map that out for you in VC, and the whole thing will just chunter away to itself in the background without you having to do anything at all. The other thing that is of benefit to that is something that I think your IT guys will probably thank you for, and your wallet might thank you for as well, because at the moment I would hazard a guess that your main client's cabinet, which is where the bulk of your data is likely to be, is just one big dumping ground. So you've got years worth of documents in there, and as stuff gets added in, it just becomes a bigger and bigger and bigger pot. And particularly at the very large end of the market, disk drives just don't exist or are horrendously expensive to handle that level of data. Now, obviously, the bigger firms have an IT infrastructure that's built to handle the volumes that they deal with. But equally, 10, 12, 15, 18 user firms, when you're going through a hosted desktop company, for example, and they're making you pay for each gigabyte of space you've got, and they're making you pay different levels according to the speed of the drives that they're giving you, this sort of thing can make that life easier. So each of these different cabinets can go on its own hard drive. I know they're all virtualized now, but you could put your main client's cabinet onto a really, really fast drive, which is obviously more expensive, but because the data in there is so much less than it was, your searches are now, from a technical perspective or technological perspective, now faster. But because you're dealing with less data, they're also having to trawl through less rubbish at the database side of things. So everything is sped up from a user perspective. And then as you start to hive this stuff off down the line, sort of there, so you've got your active cabinet, and then stuff gets put into the semi-archive, and then it moves to the full archive, and stuff goes into X clients. And then when it's been in there for a particular period of time, you reach this sort of equilibrium. And obviously, as you get busier and you get more work in, these bars will get higher, but that's never a bad thing. More work is more money, so it's okay to spend a bit more on your IT infrastructure. But you will reach this sort of equilibrium where stuff is just flowing permanently towards this destroy bit. And once stuff goes into this archive cabinet, we'll leave it there for 12 months, 18 months, enough time for someone to be able to have a look through it and go, okay, this is all stuff that we don't need anymore. And then as it hits a particular date, VC just destroys it, removes any record of it ever having existed in VC whatsoever. And you don't need to care, because from a compliance perspective, you are now adhering to a documented retention policy. I mean, we obviously use all of this internally, crazy not to. And we got an ISO accreditation about 18 months ago, there or thereabouts. I don't know if any of you ever been through that sort of thing, but basically someone shows up at your office with a completely undigital, massive lever arch file full of checkboxes that need to be ticked before they will go away and give you a certificate. But because we use all of this stuff fully, particularly around the security perspective and the retention perspective and access and stuff like that, he just sat there and just ticked pages and pages of boxes day after day, because it's all there. So if it's there, use it. Final thing I would like to just mention quickly is a new module of Virtual Cabinet, slightly separate product. It's a cloud-based product. It's around automation of to-do tasks, communication, collaboration. It's something for you to use internally within your teams, and then you can bring clients into it as well and talk about your documents. So obviously we've integrated it into VC. So you can be sat in GetBusy talking to one of your clients, and with one click, you can pull a document from VC into it, and then you can take it offline, mess about with it, agree it with your client, and then push it back to VC thereafter. So there are videos on the internet about that and how it works. So if it is something that would be of use to you, please do have a look, and obviously get in touch with us should you so desire. Sorry, I have got a few questions here already. Let me have a look. Okay, someone is just writing a question. Bear with me 10 seconds. Wow, okay, fine. Will notes from this session be provided? Yeah, of course. I mean, there's a recording of this, so you can listen to me to your heart's content for as long as you desire. I'm more than happy to send out the PowerPoint presentation. Specific notes I haven't written, but yeah, I'm happy to send you any clarifications that you like. Someone has said, when you change a client code on VC, we have to reindex all linked files. Yes, unfortunately, we have to have a consistent sort of piece of information to hang off of. So if you have a client code and a name, if the name changes, the code doesn't. So we know that where the code ABC123 is for Miss Smith and everything in VC is ABC123 Miss Smith, if on the CRM that changes to Mrs. Jones, we know the code ABC123 is Mrs. Jones, so we change everything in VC. If you change the code, we have no unique reference to hang off of. There are some third-party pieces of software that have like a secret unique identifier that we can get to in the database. So if that is the case with yours, I don't actually know what your third-party software is, but if that is the case with yours, then yes, we have a solution. But in my experience, my suggestion would be don't change your client codes. Someone said, can you set the retract on a letter basis or only as a group setting? I would basically, the default is set universally. So irrespective of who you are and where you are in the business, the default will be set centrally. But you as an individual can change it at any point when you're publishing that document. So it'll be set to a month. There's a drop down there. I mean, I can show you really quickly on my screen when I go to publish. Just bear with me 2 seconds. So on here, my auto retract here, it says automatically retract documents in 1 month at the bottom. You might not be able to see it because of the resolution, but when I click there, there's a massive drop down with about 60 different options that I can pick from at the point of publication. And I would say if you are the person in your firm who does most of the publishing and you're constantly changing it because the default's not right, consider changing the default. I mean, it's 10 seconds work. Okay, so when publishing documents in the portal, is it possible that some of the populated fields can be changed automatically? E.g., it goes out with the description accounts for approval, and when it comes back, the description field is automatically populated with accounts digitally signed. Yes, I would say. So if I show you what this looks like, so I've got a couple of signed documents in my in tray at the moment. So what I will do quickly, in portal settings, you can set what the default naming convention is for documents that go out. So I would normally have this set to description. So if you've got, let's say, accounts for approval, or just set of accounts might be a little bit better for the sake of ambiguity. So sending out a set of accounts via the portal, that will default in because it's the description of the document in VC. And then when it comes back, what it will look like is like there. Portal signed - set of accounts from George Brown on date. So while it's not dynamic in the sense that you can change lots of words, as long as your initial description is correct, as it were, when it comes back, it says portal signed in front of it. And then over here on the right, you can see all the filing information is already filled. So all I do is click file. And then when I go back and look at the client file, the signed and the unsigned will be next to each other and very immediately discernible because one of them's got portal signed at the beginning of it. Can you confirm how you get signed documents sent to a group in tray? Yeah, so what you have to do is create a pseudo user called, I don't know, the tax team or something. I think I've got one in here. Called the tax team. And then when you turn on publish delegation, we allow you to then publish on behalf of other users. So when anyone in that tax team goes to publish a document, we can set it to default that rather than publishing from them as an individual, it will publish from the whole team. And then when it comes back in, it goes into the team or the pseudo user in tray, the tax team in tray. And then anyone who has access to that in tray can then go in and file those documents. Someone said, are these functions all in the standard VC or are they extras? Mix and match. Most of them are extras. I'd imagine the obvious question anybody is going to ask now is how much are those extras? The question is dependent on complexity, size, number of users, amount of hassle we have to go through to get it working, etc., and how much of a bespoke service you want. So I'm not being deliberately vague, I promise, but if there is stuff here that you want to know about and you want an indicative price in terms of either licensing or consultancy time to set it up, speak to your account manager and they will be able to tell you. I mean, some of them are almost nothing, some of them are not, but you just have to find out, I think. Pseudo user, is it paid for or free? There's a sort of a judgment call on that. It depends. If it's one or two, I probably wouldn't charge someone for it. We get a certain amount of leeway on that. But if you've got 30 of them, then we'd probably have to have a different conversation, I think. But again, it just kind of depends. Is virtual printer functionality standard or extra cost? That is an extra cost, but it's not enormous. But again, it depends what you want, because some of my guys might be doing a million documents a year. And for us to support that and the critical level that it is for their business, obviously we charge them accordingly. If you're doing 50 a month, then, you know, it's a very different kettle of fish. So again, I'm not being deliberately vague. We just have to know what you want and then we can give you a quote for it. Where can we find document creation? That's something that we need to set up for you, but it's not a particularly onerous task for us. Again, unless you want us to set up 100 templates, but I wouldn't recommend paying us our hourly rate for that. I would do that yourselves. How can you increase the number of letters that can be used in the publishing free text area? That is held in the company administration bit here. So in the admin tab, under portal, there's a company administration bit. I mean, one thing I would say is I'll say this hesitantly with lots of caveats, don't do anything stupid, but don't ever be afraid just to have a click around and see if you can find something that you're looking for. You probably won't destroy anything. But if you click on this company administration bit here, where it says publishing options, there's an edit button next to that. And then there's message length and you can have that. I think 5,000 is the limit, but my personal thoughts would be if you're writing more than 5,000 characters in a portal message, you're writing too much. Does document creation include emails? I would go with no. I'd say no on that. It's really designed for Word documents. Do we set the watch folder up for you? Yes, of course. Anything on this stuff. Some of it's much easier than other bits. The watch folders and the template recognition stuff is reasonably horrendous. I do have some clients with very big IT teams and a bit more spare time who have dedicated the time and effort to learn how to set this OCR template matching up themselves, but they are very few and far between. So all of that stuff will hold your hands for. The virtual printer stuff will probably let you do yourselves. The document creation you do yourselves. It just depends really on which bits we're doing and how you want it to work. I think that's all the questions. Does anyone else have anything? Okay, Noel, I think I've just got it's more of a support issue, a CCH integration that's not working as it should do. That's fine. We should be able to sort that out. I've got loads and loads of CCH clients and that should be fine. So let support have a look at it. And if it's a technical issue, then they can fix it. And if it's more of a setup and how it's working issue, then we'll bump it up to the consultants and they can spend an hour or so just looking at what you need. And obviously we won't charge you for that, what you need and how it should be working. And hopefully they'll be able to fix it reasonably rapidly. For the template setup, Mahfouz, speak to your account manager. That's something that we'll need to set up for you. But yeah, they'll be able to get that process moving. Cool. Any more? Okay, cool. I'll call it there, guys. Here endeth the lesson. Thank you ever so much for attending. Really good turnout today. Appreciate it. Hopefully it was useful to you. My email address, just while I remember, is on this last screen, which I will show you now. There. So george.brown@virtualcabinet.com. Either I will deal with it myself, or I will let your account manager know and get them to speak to you. But one way or the other, someone will be in touch. So yeah, again, thank you very much for attending, and I will speak to you all soon. Thank you. Bye-bye.